Hi everybody, I'm Bill Blasius, and I've been working in plastics since 1982, so I've been doing this for a while. Plastics are like one of those things that you have everywhere. You're wearing plastics right now, and when you really think about it, we're all made out of plastics, because we're going to talk a little bit about what a polymer is and what plastics are, and we'll kind of see how all this fits together. And there's three things that we're going to cover today. The first thing is, what is a plastic? And then we're going to get a little bit into recycling and try to figure out how different plastics can be separated. So, you know, like at home, you have a recycling bin, and it says mixed recycling, and you throw newspapers in there and aluminum cans in there and all different kinds of plastics into it, and it all goes off into the recycling truck and disappears and you never see it again. But someone's got to separate all that stuff apart, because it doesn't all just get mixed together. And then we're going to talk a little bit about, what does it all mean? What does it mean to the environment? And what can we do to help keep things working like a natural cycle instead of use and dispose and forget? So I'm going to talk a little bit about like what a plastic is first, and I'll talk a little bit about what I do for a job. Plastics are really, really long chain molecules. So, like, you've all heard of carbon dioxide. It's just the carbon and two oxygens. So that's not a lot of atoms, right? There's just three, carbon, two oxygens. Something like candle wax might be 14 carbons. So now you've gone from something that's a gas that you can't even see with just one carbon to something with 14 to 20 carbons. And now it's a solid. But like, how strong are candles? Like, if you wanted to lift somebody up with a candle, like, would that work? No, so there's not a lot of strength. So having 14 carbons, it's a lot stronger than having one carbon, but it's still not really structural. Like, you're not gonna package something in a candle, and you're not going to build a car out of a candle. Now, when you get up around 100,000 carbons, now it starts to behave like things that you're used to seeing, like a milk jug or a water bottle. So those are really big molecules. And this is my best macaroni art ever. I've always tried to figure out, like, what's the best way to show somebody what a polymer is. And what we do as polymer chemists is we start off with one unit. So there's just one little piece. Like, for a milk jug, which is polyethylene, that's a hint. You might want to remember that or forget it. Your choice. Ethylene, two carbons. That's all there is to it. And then you start linking them up, and you get 100,000 of them, 200,000, half a million of them, and you start to form a really big, strong chain. And you have a bunch of these chains, and they all start to reinforce each other. And that's where all the strength comes from. Now, two families of plastics. There's thermoset plastics. These are things that are cured, and they never melt again. So, like the plastic for a circuit breaker, it's called phenolic. This thing, once it's formed, it's done. You can't do anything else with it. And car tires and bungee cords are different kinds of thermosets because they're really stretchy. But again, once they're cured, nothing happens. And the reason that is if you have one chain of the phenolic, for example, and another chain, well, they could, if you heat these up, they could separate and come apart. But these are actually cross-linked. They form like a three-dimensional network, so they really can't ever melt again. And that's good for a lot of reasons. And actually, the desktops are probably melamine, another thermoset. So if you need really good heat resistance and really good chemical resistance, like you don't want your breaker box to catch on fire or melt. So really good thing. Car tires generate a lot of heat with rolling down the highway. You don't want your car tires melting on the road. So sometimes it just makes a lot of sense to have something that cross-links and becomes a thermoset. The bad side is you can't really do much with it afterwards. That's going into a landfill. Maybe it'll get ground up and put into something else as a filler, but there's not a lot of use for it, which is kind of unfortunate. The other side are thermoplastics, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. So thermosets are a lot like that candle we were talking about. So you've melted candles, right? And it gets hot. It turns into like a little pool of liquid wax. And what happens to the wax after it cools?
It becomes hot.
It sure does. And then you light the candle up again and it melts again. And it turns into a little pool of wax and you let it cool and it goes solid again. That's exactly what thermoplastics do. So they don't have any of those cross links in between. They're just really, really long chains and they can always be separated with some heat. So some of the jobs that I've done, all my show and tells here. Oh, actually, I'm going to back up a little bit. In college, as an undergraduate, I studied biology. So I learned a lot about biology and chemistry and biochemistry. And one thing that you learn in biochemistry is like how people are built and things are built. And how many people have heard of amino acids? Okay, so you start with something really simple like an amino acid, which is just a couple of carbons, some nitrogen, some oxygen. And then you start linking up amino acids. And then you have proteins. And then from proteins, you can start building things like collagen and muscles. And next thing you know, people are walking around. So for me, going from biochemistry to plastics was really kind of simple because industrial plastics are a lot, or industrial polymers, are a lot less complicated than biological polymers that we're all made out of, our hair, our fingernails, our muscles. Bones aren't, those are inorganic, but most of us are built out of polymers. So it was a pretty easy shift for me to do that. So some of the things that I've done and made through the years, so this is a thermoset drive belt, and it's made out of polyurethane with Kevlar reinforcement. And things like this, I think this one might even go on like a vacuum cleaner drive, but back in the day when there were actually floppy drives in computers, those were all driven by belts. I used to make stuff like that. And I've also done some odd things with actually a material called cellulose acetate, which is derived from trees, the cellulose piece of it. like Ron was saying, that people, plants, all the things are made out of polymers. Well, sometimes you can modify them just a little bit and you can use them just like a normal synthetic polymer. So like gambling dice and plastic eyeglass frames. And then I went off to a place that did a lot of coated fabrics, and they did a lot of work for the military. And this is an offcut of a really long roll of material that would get fabricated into what looks like a giant pillowcase. And the military, actually it's giant to the size of like half a football field. And the military, if they want to put in a airfield somewhere, like they just need some spot where planes need to refuel, they can build an instant tank farm using this kind of fabrics so that it'll all be hot welded together and turned into this giant pillowcase and filled up with jet fuel. And also while the military is deploying people, they need to set up hospitals and cafeterias and things like that. So they need some really lightweight, strong tenting material. And this was another thing that I was doing. The green actually reflects infrared so it looks like a tree. So if someone's using night vision glasses and they're looking around for some telltale sign of people, all they'll see is like the reflection of what would look like a tree. So it all just kind of blurs into the background. And the black is dense enough so that you can have lights on in a hospital operating room and no one could see that light from the outside. Like there wouldn't be any leakage. Thank you. I didn't actually make these tumblers, but I did for a while. Remember, we were talking about having just that one unit and then turning it into the long chain. Well, that's what I was doing for a living for a while, too. I was taking the monomers, which is the one little unit, so mono, one, turning it into a polymer, poly, many. And I was making the plastic that would go into things like this. And so one of the bigger applications was the knobs on your tubs, those big, they look like glass, but they're plastic. So that was my life for a while. Right now, I'm working in medical plastics. Things very similar to this. Making the compounds that get extruded into the tubes. Most of the applications for the company I work at right now, Foster in Putnam, Connecticut, goes into cardiology catheters. So if you know anyone who's like ever had to get an angioplasty or have a stent put into the arteries of their heart, we make the plastics that surgeons use to put the stent in place. It has to be what they call radio opaque. So with an x-ray, the surgeons can follow where the catheter is inside the patient. So they'll go up inside their leg, follow the arteries until they find just the right clogged one, and they can either blow up a balloon and unclog the artery, or they can put a stent in, or both. Some of the really trickiest ones are just like super, super thin, and surgeons can actually start in your leg and they'll work their way all the way up into your brain. And if you have an aneurysm or something like that, they can put something into that aneurysm, which an aneurysm is like a ballooned out piece of a vein, which may or may not burst. And if it bursts in your head, not a good thing. so they can plug that before anything bad happens. So this is what I'm doing right now, and it's kind of fun. And it, yeah, every day you can go home and think, I helped somebody somehow. What we're going to talk about today is about recycling. It's amazing to see how recycling has grown over the last 20 years. There was a time when like everything needed to be sorted individually, like water bottles had to go here and plastic and milk jugs had to go there. And people just wouldn't do it because it was too much to it. It was really awkward. Or you had to separate plastics from metal from paper. Well, now you can put everything together. But that makes you wonder, like, how does that work? How can you separate these things? And I'm going to play a little clip from Monty Python. And there's a little bit of a hint in there for you.
How do we tell whether she is made of wood? Does a wood sink in water?
No,
it floats. What also floats in water?
Bread. Apples.
Very small rocks.
Cider.
A great gravy.
Cherries.
Mud.
Churches.
Lead.
A duck.
Exactly. So, logically,
if she weighs the same as a duck, she's made of wood.
And therefore,
a witch!
A witch!
Okay, so that was a little silly. I admit that. But they were kind of on the right track. So they were trying to figure out whether the woman was made out of wood or stone, or whether she weighed the same as a duck. But they're trying to get at a really simple thing, which was, how dense is she? Everything has a different density. So, you know, some of the things that they were throwing out there that float, like wood and small stones and lead and churches, all have different densities. Some things do float, like ducks float and wood floats, and some things sink, like rocks and lead. Well, every plastic has a different density. You know, if you were just to grab a bottle of polyethylene, a bottle of polyester, it might seem about the same. But when you start getting a little bit more scientific about it and actually weighing it in different liquids, you can tell the difference. So what I've done is, starting with water, which is like the standard reference, is the density of water is 1 at room temperature. It's been filtered and deionized, so it's pretty close. And then to make the denser solutions, I added some Epsom salt, magnesium sulfate, and it followed a chart to make sure that I had the right percentage. And actually, you'd be amazed at like how much salt is in some of these things. So I did that for the denser ones. And for the less dense ones, I added isopropanol to the water, rubbing alcohol. So that way things would sink easier, essentially. So here's a question for you. When you're floating in the water, do you feel like it's easier to float in salt water or in fresh water? So is it easier to float at the beach or in someone's pool? It's a lot easier to float in salt water. And yeah, there's some places like the Dead Sea in the Middle East where you basically can't sink. No matter what you try, you're just gonna bob up. It's because the density of the water is really high and you don't change and you're mostly water. So your density is just like a little bit above 1. So if the density of the water you're trying to float in is like 1.3 or something crazy like that, you just can't sink into it. So we're going to use that same concept to kind of figure out what plastics float in these different liquids and which ones don't. Back in the early days of recycling, that's actually how people would separate the different plastics. They would just chop them all up, run them through all these different liquids, and depending on who sank and who floated, they would take different cuts away. So that was how it was done, how we're going to do a little experiment now. So I've got a box of stuff, and our activity is going to be to cut these things up and dip them into the different liquids. And we have essentially a score sheet. And we're going to use our results to try to figure out what these different packaging materials are made out of. Yeah, who wants to go first?
Come on up.
Yeah, why don't you pick out a piece of trash? Actually, you can even take the top off the milk jug if that's what you'd like to do. Here's your plastic. Just dunk it in to some density liquid that you think is going to kind of match up with the density of the plastic that you think it might be. And it floats. Okay, so for all of you following along, if you want to put like an F for floats and S for sinks, so this floated in 1.16. That's the milk jug top. I'm going to pull that out of there and give it a quick dunk in the rinse so we don't cross-contaminate the liquids. That's good. You can use the pliers. Okay, so it floated in that. So that means that liquid is denser than the plastic. So if we want to figure out what that plastic is, we're going to need to go to something with a liquid with a lower density still. So we have to move to your left to figure out what that might be. So you started at 1.16, so you need to move to one or any of the 0.9s. You can go all the way. Go ahead. And it sank in the 0.90. Okay, pull it out, rinse it. But it didn't sink very fast, did it? No, it just kind of like settled slowly. Yeah, I think so, huh? So what do you think, the next one? Okay. A floater. Okay, so it floats at 0.95. That leaves you one more choice, right? Yeah.
I don't think it floats.
Nope, that sank too. So it's somewhere between 0.93 and 97? 95. So you have the water bottle top, right? And it sank in
that one.
90. And it floated in 9.3?
Yeah. Then
and
it sank in...
It floated in 9.5.
It floated?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought it sank.
It floated in everybody, except for the 9.0. Now you know that the real density is somewhere between 0.90 and 0.93.
So going off the charts, there's a couple of options. So which ones do you think they might be? Yeah, high density.
Yeah, from those results, it absolutely looks like high density. Everything's supposed to have a recycling code on it. This doesn't, which is odd.
And it very well may be polyethylene. Most caps are made out of polypropylene, which we'll see for sure if we do some of the other caps. But yes, well done.
Okay, somebody else want to try? You might want to bring your chart and just follow along as you do it.
Grab a piece of thing to be recycled.
Oh, okay. Another cap.
Yeah, the hard thing is just because of the shape and how it...
So, you saw what one cap did. Do you think this one's very different than that?
Probably not.
Okay, so where do you think you want to start?
It floats.
It floats.
So it floats at 1.16.
I'll pull that out and rinse it.
Okay, and then pick another liquid that might be a little bit lower density.
6.
And then kind of comes back. Yeah, that's kind of close.
But no, that's floating at 0.95.
So you need to go lower still. And it sank at 0.90. And it floats.
And sinks.
There you go. So you don't really know where to start, so maybe someplace in the middle?
Sinks in water 1.0. So you need to go to something denser. Sank in 1.22. Sank in 1.34. Yeah, funny shape, huh? And it sank in 1.28. So where does that leave us? It sank in 1.34. Okay, so what's the densest plastic that you have on that sheet?
Yeah, the PET.
The density of the plastic really, it changes with how it's processed. So we did a pretty good job of figuring this out, I think. So one question before we finish up. So you saw how things sink, float in different liquids, and fresh water and salt water have different densities. So what do you think happens when plastics get out into the environment and get into either a lake or into the ocean? Any ideas? Like maybe
think
some
about
of the
what happened to that juice water when you put it in the plain water? What happened to that plastic?
It melts.
It sinks. So if we get plastics in our lakes, what's going to happen to them?
Yeah, and think about what lives in the lake, right? Is it going to affect their homes?
Is that fire protection?
I work with plastics for the healthcare industry, mostly catheters and things like that. But in the past, I've worked also with packaging materials. And I really care about where plastics end up because it really reflects on the industry, and I'm pretty proud of the industry. And what we did today is we ran through some different plastics to see how they could be separated and sorted and reused efficiently and economically. And what we did is we just took some representative packaging materials, and the kids went through the gradient and figured out exactly what the density of the mystery plastic was and assigned a name to it.